There's no way to measure all your worth. You were crucified and laid behind the stone. You lived to die, rejected and alone, like a rose trampled on the ground. You took the fall.
Good morning, Ladue Church.
Ah,
some enthusiasm. Hi, Greg.
Hi.
We're here this morning to sing some praises and some worships and listen to, I think, Doug's got a video for us later on. And it's all for the Lord. Everything we do is for the Lord. And he makes sure that it comes back to us and is set in our minds and bodies and so that we can follow him. Well, I got a song to sing here right off the bat, and then I guess we get on with the announcements. So if you could, if you want to, stand. If you can, fine. If you can't, stay in your chair. That's fine. So I'll have to... Sounds about right.
I hear the Savior say, your strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me your all in all. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin has left us crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Lord, now indeed I find your power and yours alone can change the leper's spots and melt a heart of stone. Jesus paid it all, to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Nor nothing good have I, whereby your grace to claim. I'll wash my garments white in the blood of Jesus' name. Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat, Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin has left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.
Thank you. You may be seated. I love it too.
Are we on?
No, that's a switch at the back. No, he has the switch.
He does. Are we on now?
Now you are.
Okay. Before we do the announcements, I just want to draw your attention to this. Anyone know what those first two words mean? Now, I know Roy's back here somewhere. I know he knows. I am is one of the names of God, and it means to be eternally existent. So when you read this verse, I am, the eternally existent one is the resurrection and the life. Doesn't that mean something a little bit different? I think it does. Whoever believes in me, the eternally existent one, shall live. And the word shall is a legal term. You will have it. Just an interesting thought, wouldn't you think? So that kind of changes that verse a little bit when you look at it that way. Well, let's try the announcements. Let's see what we've got for the announcements. Soup and bun today. All in favor? Yes, for sure. All right, next one. Plan to protect. Is Kim here? She's busy. She's in the back. Okay. If you're involved with children of any age, you need a refresher course. Okay, a legal requirement there. Okay. The Band of Brothers. Now, where are we? Back here. Anything you want to say about that, Doug? Nothing. All right, and they've had some good turnouts on that. So, men, you can get together with that one. And what do we have next? Good Friday, 10:30 in the morning will be our service for that one. And like I've said, we are going to remember the I Am and what he did for each one of us. Oh, yes. All right, 10:30 next week. And baptism, what a special thing to keep happening. When people declare outwardly what they've done inwardly, good things are happening. When people come to the Lord or rededicate their life to the Lord, a public statement is ideal. It's really good. Okay, next. And he says that is it. So we're going to let Tom have the floor once again. We're glad you're here. If you're a visitor, welcome. And if you're here as a regular, you're also welcome. How's that, eh?
That's all covering.
Well, that's right, Tom, for sure. All right, so we will get back to the song service.
Okay. Okay, got a couple of more songs before we go to the service. The one I'm going to sing now is called My Savior's Love, and it starts out, I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me as sinner, condemned, unclean. That's the first verse. So if you'd like to stand, if you can, if you can't, don't worry about it. Just stay right where you are, and we'll try and get this done. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. In the garden, he prayed not my will but thine. He had no tears for his own griefs, but sweat drops of blood for mine. How wonderful, how marvelous, and my song shall ever. How wonderful is my Savior's love for me. He took my sins and my sorrows. He made them his very own. He bore the burden to Calvary and
suffered and died alone. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. When with the ransomed in I at last shall see, and will be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Thank you. Not my will, Lord, but thine. Okay, O Master, let me walk with thee in lowly paths of service free. Tell me thy secret, help me to bear the strain of toil and the fret of care. That's the verse of the next song that's called, O Master, Let Me Walk With Thee. Sounds familiar? Okay, key of C, very good. We'll try that one.
O Master, let me walk with thee in lowly paths of a service free. Tell me thy secret. Some clear winning word of love. Teach me the wayward feet to stay and guide them in the homeward way. Teach me thy patience still with thee in closer company, in work that keeps thy face sweet and strong, in trust that triumphs over wrong, in hope that sends a shining ray far down the future's broadening that only thou canst give. Hold me, O Master, let me live with thee, O Master, let me live.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Good morning, everybody. As you know, Pastor Shannon's not here, so you're stuck with me.
That's okay.
Oh, thanks, Greg. Yeah. Shannon did give me permission for an hour and a half sermon, though. Is that okay? I'm just kidding. Anyways, I just want to read this morning. Like, I subscribe to, it's called Higher Aim. And the one that came this morning really struck me, so I would just like to share. And it's from Luke 14:27. And whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. And then he writes, one of the most famous statements Jesus ever made was this: you must take up that cross, deny yourself, and follow me. I want you to understand what he is saying when he makes the statement. He's saying to us, his followers, I want you to die every day and to do what you want and follow me. In other words, you need to see your old self, that old sin nature, nailed to the cross. This is not something that we need to be thinking about once a year. Instead, you must choose to live dead to yourself every single day. Your old sin nature has been crucified with Christ. He broke the master link of sin in your life because of the cross. We constantly need to mentally, emotionally, and spiritually see that our old sin nature has been nailed to the cross. The image of someone carrying a cross makes us think about what happened in Via Dolorosa as Jesus was led out to the place where he was crucified. We need to understand what Jesus said to his disciples long before he was crucified. He was laying the groundwork for us to understand what it means to be a disciple following him. We need to live crucified lives. And while this seems to be a lot to ask of us, we can't forget that the cross has the power to set us free, even now. Because of what Jesus did for us on the cross, we are set free. We need to stay in that position of dying to self and dying to what we want and dying to what we want to happen. Now, I realize you might be experiencing many things in your life, right now that didn't even appear on your dream list years ago. And while it's a tough set of circumstances to be dealing with, the only way you can walk through those uncomfortable and painful times is to see yourself dead on the cross. Your sin nature gives you those desires to have your way rather than God's way. But when you submit to that aspect of denying yourself, that is taking up your cross. And this was written by, and I'm sorry, I've gone brain dead, and I don't have the name. Oh. But anyways, it's called Higher Aim, and if anybody's interested, I mean, you can subscribe to it. I read it every morning, and I find it very inspiring. So again, I just want to welcome everybody here this morning, and let us just have a pastoral prayer, if you bow with me. Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you for allowing us to come here this morning to worship in freedom. We do lift up prayer requests to you. I ask that you be with Pastor Shannon, Lynette, as they are helping Taylor in Calgary. And I thank you for the gentleman that went down to help the move on Thursday. Thank you for watching over us as we went down in inclement weather and safely bringing us back. We do have health issues in our church, Lord, and we just ask for healing for Krista Aris, Miles Moorside, Jake and Vera Berg, Jim Michaels, Lord, and anybody else that is needing your healing touch. We just ask that you would touch and make them better. We do ask that you be with Michael's family as they are hoping to get to Canada, Lord, and they're in the final stages of the application. We just trust that everything will go well and that there will be no glitches. I just want to pray for all the people at McMahon, Lord. We just want to pray for Greg, Trevor, Reagan, all the staff there. Just bless them. And I thank you that they're able to come and be with us most Sunday mornings. We do also want to pray for our governments, Lord. We just ask that you be with City Council, Lord, as they are dealing with things, particularly with the demise of the hub at this point in time, Lord. I just ask that you would help to put them on look for a new place for them to be. In the meantime, they are having to close down, Lord, so we just ask that you be with the city people as they're hoping to help them resolve that. We ask that you be with our people, our MLAs, Lord. I thank you that we have such a great government here in Alberta, Lord, and that they are looking after us or trying to look after us, Lord. So we just ask that you continue to be with them. We also want to ask that you be with all our federal MPs, Thank you, Lord, that we do pray for our prime minister, even though we might disagree with him at times, Lord. We just ask that your spirit be with them and that they be with you, be with all of the members of parliament, and that they consider looking after us, Lord, and that you would just help them to, that your Holy Spirit would be there with them as they make decisions on us. And we do ask, Lord, that you just bless the rest of this week. Help us to prepare for Good Friday, Lord, and Easter Sunday. And we thank you that we are able to do that. We thank you that the Holy Spirit is here with us. And we just ask that you bless the rest of the service. And we just ask all of this in your precious name. Amen. Kids are dismissed to children's church. And that's it. So the message today is not me, but we do have a video message that Pastor Shannon asked that we set up. So we are going to listen to that now, and it's I think you will enjoy it. You ready? Okay.
Text this morning is in Revelation chapter 1. You have your Bibles, please open to Revelation chapter 1, beginning at verse 4. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia, grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits that are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings on earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom of priests to his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming with the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him, and all tribes of the earth will wail on account of him. Even so, amen. You may be seated. Whenever we speak about the book of Revelation, there is a sense of trepidation. We're afraid of this book. I remember when I first came to faith, and again, you have to understand that I did not grow up in church. I didn't grow up around Christianity. I was raised by a single teenage Buddhist mother and never heard the gospel until my first year in university. I had some teammates of mine on the football team who discipled me, who bought me my first Bible, and for some reason, it just seemed like a good idea to me to start at the end. So the first book I ever read all the way through was Revelation. Worst decision ever. I do not recommend it. Amen? And so we do. We have a sense of trepidation. It's as though Revelation is this mystical book that cannot be understood and certainly doesn't have practical application for those of us living in the here and the now. And there are a number of reasons for this, partly because it's been so sensationalized over the years. There are people who've gone to the book of Revelation with absolute certainty about the issues of the day being the issues of the end time. We knew for absolute sure that Hitler was the Antichrist and that was the end. We knew for absolute sure, we were certain that when the Gulf War started, that's ancient Babylon, this is gonna be the Battle of Armageddon, it's all coming to pass, we're done. There are books written. Perhaps the most famous of those is 88 Reasons Christ Will Return in 1988. And because of this sensationalism and because of these false predictions, again, many believe that perhaps the book ought to be avoided. But there are other reasons that we avoid the book. One is the type of literature. We're not very familiar with apocalyptic literature. It's not something that we understand very readily. But you need to be aware that apocalyptic literature is absolutely something that those who received the book of Revelation would have understood. They would have known in an instant what type of literature was being presented. I guess the equivalent for us would be a fairy tale. If someone starts a story with you with once upon a time, that's all you need to know in order to know that we're probably about to hear a fairy tale, because it's a popular type of literature and you're well aware of the rules surrounding that type of literature. Well, we're not well aware of the rules surrounding apocalyptic literature, so it tends to make us uncomfortable. Another reason it makes us uncomfortable is because Revelation quotes the Old Testament incessantly, more than any other book in the New Testament. And, well, we're very unfamiliar with the Old Testament. Amen? We're just, most Christians are not, perhaps not here at Christ Church, but most Christians are just not very familiar with the Old Testament. Not only are there more Old Testament references in Revelation than any other book, but more than half of those references come from Psalms, Isaiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel. And guess what? Isaiah, Ezekiel, and Daniel are the same type of apocalyptic literature, prophetic literature, with which we're rather unfamiliar. Daniel contains the most in proportion to its length, but in terms of actual references, Isaiah is first. And so, if we're unfamiliar with the Old Testament, if we're uncomfortable with the Old Testament, then we'll be unfamiliar with and uncomfortable with the book of Revelation. Then there are the symbols, which again are very common in apocalyptic literature. But if you're not familiar with apocalyptic literature, then you don't understand how colors and animals and lampstands and spirits and keys and the like help to interpret the story. Oftentimes we try to use, for example, interpretive tools that we would use for one type of literature, for this type of literature. And an example of that is an example that, you know, I was familiar with when I was younger, even before I became a Christian, not going to church. I grew up in Los Angeles, and there were a lot of black nationalists at the time in Los Angeles, a lot of black nationalist movements. Principal among them was the Nation of Islam. And the Nation of Islam would often go to the book of Revelation, where, you know, Jesus is pictured there with feet as burnished bronze and hair like wool. And they would say, look, he's a black man. Now, if you understand apocalyptic literature, then you know that feet of burnished bronze is a picture of judgment, and hair like wool is a picture of the Ancient of Days, the wise judge. But even if you don't know that, all you have to know is that in that same description, his eyes are like fire, which ought to clue you in to the fact that the author's not being literal. But I cannot tell you how many people argue Jesus' skin color based on that symbolic color given in the book of Revelation, because we take this type of literature and try to use rules from other types of literature in order to interpret it, which again leads to errors that lead us away from the book. Then there are the numbers. The numbers in the book. And these are important for us this morning. There are several important numbers in the book. The number three is important. The number three is important because it's the number for God, our triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The number four is important because it's the number for creation. Four angels, four corners of the earth, four winds. By the way, Christians have never thought or taught that the earth was flat until recently. There are a number of Christians running around making that argument, but we've always understood that those were symbolic. The four corners of the earth doesn't mean that the earth is flat and has four corners, but the number four is a reference to the earth. And so the four corners of the earth means all of the earth, four living creatures, every tribe, language, people, and nation. What does that mean? All the peoples of the earth. The number seven, number of completion. We see it in our text a number of times. Seven churches, seven spirits, seven golden lampstands, seven stars, seven seals, seven horns, seven eyes, seven angels, seven trumpets, and on and on and on. The number of 10 is another number of completion. It's a different kind of completion, though. Number 12, the number of the people of God. 12 tribes, 12 apostles, 12 stars above the woman's head. And then there are multiples of these numbers. 24 before the throne, a 12 and a 12. The 144,000, 12 times 12 times 1,000. Again, when we understand these numbers and their meanings, it takes away some of the mystery and it helps us to understand what was being communicated. And there's a simple message in the book of Revelation, and that simple message is this: God is in control and he will triumph in the end. That's the message of this book. So anyone who goes to the book of Revelation and reads it and comes away afraid does so because of a lack of understanding of the text. The last thing we should come away with from Revelation is fear. Unless, of course, we are outside of the camp and outside of the kingdom, in which case, be afraid. Be very, very afraid. But don't stay afraid. Repent and flee to the Lamb and be saved. Well, with that, let's look at Revelation chapter 1. I want you to note this as well. Interestingly enough, Revelation is arguably the easiest book in the New Testament to memorize. And one of the reasons that it's easy to memorize is because of all of the numbers and all of the colors and all of the imagery, but also because there's a pattern in the book of Revelation. I call it the Revelation Waltz. You know, kind of a 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. The number three is the number for God, but it's also a rhetorical tool that's used in Revelation. We'll see that. For example, look at Revelation chapter 1 and verse 1. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him, there's one, to show to his servants the things that must take place. He made it known, there's two, by sending his angel to his servant John, and then three, who bore witness to the word of God, to the testimony of Jesus Christ, and to all that he saw. Now, there's two threes there. Number one, it's the revelation of Jesus Christ, God gave to him, he made it known, right? And then John bore witness. What did John bear witness to? He bore witness to the word of God, the testimony of Jesus Christ, and to all that he saw. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. Verse 3. Blessed is, number 1, the one who reads aloud the words of this prophecy. And blessed are, number 2, those who hear. And, number 3, who keep what is written in it, for the time is near. There's a pattern here, and if you read the book of Revelation, you see that pattern. Again, that's why I refer to it as the Revelation Waltz. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So here that number is more the rhythm of the text than it is pointing to something symbolic. But in our text, beginning at verse 4, we see something amazing appear. If I had to title this message, the title would be Worthy of Worship. We begin in verse 4. John, to the seven churches that are in Asia. Now, there were more than seven churches in Asia at the time Revelation was written. But the seven churches that are referred to, that are addressed directly in this letter, are actually churches that exist on a circular postal route. That number seven is the number for completion, or the number for perfection, if you will. That makes it different than the number 10. 10 is always just completion, but this seven is the number of perfect completion. So this circular postal route with seven churches, John is saying that he's writing to God's perfect church, God's complete church. In other words, this letter that John is writing is not just relevant to those churches in Asia, not just relevant to the church of his day. To the seven churches that are in Asia, grace to you and peace from, watch this, him who is and who was and who is to come. 1, 2, 3. This three, however, is referring to God. And we know this because God is the one who is and who was and who is to come. And from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ. So there's another three. Him who was and who is to come, from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ. But there's a question that is raised here. If you just read this, immediately the question is, what's the reference there to the seven spirits who are before his throne? What is that about? A couple of clues. Number one, the number seven. But secondly, if you go forward to Revelation chapter 4. Revelation chapter 4. In Revelation 4 and 5 is a picture of worship before the throne of God. It is absolutely awe-inspiring. But in Revelation chapter 4 and verse 5, we read, from the throne came flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder. And before the throne were burning seven torches of fire, which are the seven spirits of God. Again, this number seven, a number of perfection, a number of completion. So whatever this is, it's perfect spirit. The other thing that makes this clear is that it's part of another triad. So him who was and who is to come, that's God the Father. And we know that the third one in this triad is Jesus Christ. So it makes sense that the second one in this triad that is referred to as spirit would be God the Spirit. In other words, grace to you and peace from the Father and the Spirit and the Son. Grace to you and peace from the triune God. Why is Christ worthy of worship? Well, Christ is worthy of worship first and foremost because he is God. Not like God, not close to God, not almost God, but he is God. He is the eternal Son. He is the one who spoke the world into existence. And as God, Christ is worthy of our worship. We see that, for example, again, if you look at chapter 5. Remember, I told you, Revelation 4 and 5, you put them together. There's this awe-inspiring picture of worship that is happening before the throne. Look at Revelation 5:11. Then I looked, and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the elders the voice of many angels, numbering myriads of myriads and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive, let's count them, power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. That seven thing, that sevenfold praise, that's perfect praise. The Lamb is worthy to receive perfect praise. In other words, the Lamb is worthy to receive the worship that is being offered at the throne of God. Why? Because the Lamb is God. Christ is worthy of worship because Christ is God. Not only that, but in verse 5 of our text, and from Jesus Christ, who's Jesus Christ? The faithful witness, the firstborn from the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. Now, usually when the triune God is presented in Scripture, it's Father, Son, Holy Spirit. That's the normal order that you find here. But here, John gives us Father, Spirit, and then Son. Because the point that he's making here is a point that refers to the Son, which makes sense because in verse 1, remember what we read in verse 1, the revelation of Jesus Christ, the revelation of the Son of God. That's the focal point here in Revelation. And it's also the focal point of John's message here in this first segment. From Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of kings on earth. Christ is worthy of worship, first, because he's God. Christ is also worthy of worship, however, because he is the faithful witness. Not just a faithful witness, he is the faithful witness. And what is meant here is that Christ is a witness who can only be faithful, because he's God, he's perfect, he's truth, he is the way, the truth, and the life. He can only be a faithful witness. But it's also meant here that Christ is the only witness who has been and always will be faithful. There have been other witnesses, and we're grateful for them. You could have a heavenly roll call. You could say, Adam, can you come and testify? And Adam would have to say, actually, no, I was kind of unfaithful. Okay, Abraham, how about you come and Abraham, you testify. I could, but that false frailties, sins, you don't want me. Well, David, can you, Bathsheba, well, and we could go on and on and on and on, and there would only be one. Only one. All the rest are good witnesses. Amen? All the rest are reliable witnesses, but all the rest of them are frail and flawed witnesses. But there is one witness who can only be faithful. And he is the one witness who was and is and always will be faithful. He is worthy of worship as the faithful witness. That's why we don't offer worship to Adam or to Abraham or Isaac or Jacob or to anyone else. We offer worship to God alone. Christ is God, and he's the faithful witness. Secondly, we offer worship to him. He's worthy of worship, rather, because he's the firstborn of the dead. He's the firstborn of the dead. I was having a conversation with a Jehovah's Witness not long ago, and you know, Jehovah's Witnesses argue that Jesus is the first created being, and they look at a number of texts, and you know, they always, you know, he, especially Colossians 1, and you know, the firstborn of all creation, what that means is, you know, that God created him first, and then after God created him, he created everything else. And that word firstborn there in Colossians 1 means preeminent. Firstborn does not always mean the first one born. God calls Israel his firstborn son. Israel was not the first nation born. but they are the preeminent nation in terms of God's people. And here, Jesus is the firstborn from the dead, but he's the first one who died and got up. Actually, he's not. There was another. You remember Lazarus? Lazarus was raised from the dead. Not only that, but we know that the Old Testament prophet Elijah raised someone from the dead. So this idea of Jesus being the firstborn of the dead does not mean that he's the first one who died and came back, but it means that he's preeminent. Why is he preeminent? Well, for a couple of reasons. Number one, he's preeminent because his resurrection was unlike anything else. The one whom Elijah raised, and even the one who Jesus raised, have something in common. They're dead. Amen? That always just gets me when I read about Lazarus. I'm like excited, but. And here's why. Lazarus is dead. He's gone. He's with the Lord. He's it's all good. And then he comes back to this. Worse than that, right? I mean, I can imagine people there, you know, Lazarus, maybe not immediately, but after a few days, you know, like, Lazarus, the Lord raised you from the dead. You should be the happiest man in the world. What's wrong? And he would say, I got to do that again. I was finished. I was over. I had faced that last enemy that we all fear and dread, and now I got to do it again. Not Jesus. He rose again on the third day, never to die again. He defeated death and hell and the grave. So he's firstborn of the dead because of that. But he's also firstborn of the dead because all others who hope for, anticipate, and will experience resurrection from the dead, will experience resurrection not only like he did, but because he did. We will overcome death because of Christ, the firstborn of the dead. He is worthy of worship because he's God, because he's the faithful witness, and because he's the firstborn of the dead. Thirdly, he's the ruler of kings on earth. He's the ruler of kings on earth. It's an amazing thing to meet a king. Amen? Or a president, for example. I mean, even if it's a president that you don't like. And I know people talk noise about, you know, our current president, and rightly so. Lord have mercy. But here's the thing. No matter what you think about a president, and people's passions run deep, if he invited you in and you stood before him, your knees would shake because of the office. If you stood there in the Oval Office, waiting for the door to open and for the President of the United States to walk in, your breathing would not be as calm as it is right now because of the office. It's an amazing thing. But Christ is the ruler of kings on earth. The ruler of every king on earth. The ruler of every king that has ever been and every king that ever will be. He is King of kings and Lord of lords. Every knee will bow before him and every tongue will confess. Everyone. All of the rest of the kings on earth are kings of a limited domain. There are many kings in the world right now, but none of them are my king. Amen? Not nary a one. I have another king. And even if I did live in a monarchy where there was a king, that king might be my king here and now. But as we were reminded of just a while back, even those monarchs who rule for what seems like ages and eons and lifetimes, they die. And when they die, it's like when the queen just died recently. What do you say? The queen is dead, long live the king. But there is a king who will never die. And he is the king above all other kings. He is worthy of our worship. And then, if you look at the next part of this verse, to him who loves us and freed us from our sins and made us a kingdom of priests to his Father and God. By the way, there's another three. One, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three. But just grasp this from a literary perspective for a moment. Christ is worthy of worship, first because he's God. And it's as though John is saying, he's God, worship him. He is the faithful witness. Bow the knee before him and worship him. He is the firstborn of the dead. Worship him. He is the ruler of kings on earth. I don't care what your position is. I don't care what your possessions are. Bow the knee and worship the Lord Jesus Christ. And then just before your knee goes down to worship him, you know what John would say? Get up, you're not worthy. You are not worthy to worship Christ. What an incredible position to be in. You owe God worship. You owe the Lord Jesus Christ worship. You owe him all of your worship, and you're not worthy to give him the worship that you owe. Any worship that you would offer him would be tainted worship. It would be beneath him. Unworthy of who he is as God, unworthy of who he is as the faithful witness, unworthy of who he is as the firstborn of the dead, and as the ruler of kings on earth. And then right when you're about to be crushed under the weight of the majesty of the Lord Jesus Christ, John says, to him who loves us. He's God. He's God. He's the faithful witness. He's the firstborn of the dead. He's the ruler of kings on earth. There is none like him. And he loves me. He is worthy of me bowing prostrate on my face before him and praying that I'm not consumed by the fire of his judgment. And he loves me. He loves me. Love is an amazing and significant thing, but not all loves are equal. Amen? My dogs love me. Yeah. They do, they love me. If you fed them, they'd love you too. So I'm glad my dogs love me. But they don't love me like my kids love me. It means more to me that my kids love me. And they don't love me like my wife loves me. It means more to me that my wife loves me. But not my dogs or my kids or my wife love me like my Savior loves me. There is no love like that love. Why? Who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood. Christ demonstrated his love for us, or God demonstrated his love for us in this, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Christ, who said, greater love hath no man than this, then he laid down his life for his friends. So when John says that he loves us, he's not just saying that he has warm feelings toward us. No. Love is an act of the will accompanied by emotion that leads to action on behalf of its object. He demonstrated his love in freeing us from our sins. There is none righteous, no, not one. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And yet he has freed us from our sins by his blood. He paid the penalty for our sins with his blood. And he made us a kingdom of priests to his God and Father. So watch this. Christ is worthy of worship because he's God, and because he's the faithful witness, and because he's the firstborn of the dead, and because he's the ruler of kings on earth. And the most magnificent piece of this puzzle, from my perspective, is that not only is he worthy of worship, but he makes me worthy to worship him. Look at it again. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood and made us a kingdom of priests before his God and Father. He has made us a kingdom of priests who are worthy to offer worship before the throne. And we are only worthy to worship because the one who is worthy of worship has loved us and freed us and redeemed us. God is good. If you have come here this morning and placed your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, he has made you worthy to worship the one who is worthy of worship. If you have come here this morning and do not know the Lord and the pardon of your sins, if you've come here this morning and have not come to him in repentance and faith, then I would offer you this warning. What you are doing is the right thing, but you're not yet worthy to do it in the right way. Repent of your sin. Flee from your sin. And cast yourself on the mercy of the Lord Jesus Christ. Trust in him and him alone to make you worthy, as he redeems you by his blood because of the great love with which he loves us, and grants you permission to join that kingdom of priests before his God and Father. Let's pray. God, we thank you and we praise you. We thank you and we praise you for the redemption that is ours in Christ. We thank you and we praise you for the Lord Jesus Christ, who is worthy of worship and who makes us worthy to worship. Grant by your grace that we might be found in him. And hear us, Lord, as we offer to you the prayer in the manner that our Lord taught us to pray.
It's helpful to consider that Christ did not have to come and die one time per each Christian. He did not have to die 100 times to get 100 Christians into heaven and 1,000 times to get 1,000 Christians in. But why not? Well, Scripture says that Christ came to die for his bride, the church. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25 says, Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it. If Christ died one time per each Christian, then perhaps it would be easier to find an excuse for quarrels among the saints. But Christ dying once for his bride, of which we are a part, is the death blow to any justification for fights among us. One death binds us. Christ's blood binds us. Paul says something similar about our fellowship around this one bread. He writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 17, "We, being many, are one bread and one body, for we are all partakers of that one bread. So we are one bread, partaking of one bread." This does not mean, of course, that you must be best friends with every Christian you meet. It does not mean that you have to agree with every Christian you meet about everything. But it does mean that you have to say with David, "As for the saints in the land, they are the excellent ones in whom is all my delight." We come to this table as more than an assembly of individuals. We come to this table one in Christ. For there is one body and one spirit, even as we are called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. So come in faith and welcome to Jesus Christ. Our Father, we thank you for giving us your Son. We thank you for the fellowship we have with him and with one another. Bless us now, for we come to eat and drink in Christ's name, and amen.
Here's your chart. Come to Christ, and only Christ can enable you to come to Christ. So look to him, come to him, and come to the Father through him, and with believing hearts receive the benediction of your God. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.
As I was looking for songs this last week, I had one come to me that fills the bill. This is not Easter yet. It's Palm Sunday, so this was his triumphal entry. This song takes place between now and Good Friday. So if you would like, join me, please, and we'll just sing this song and be happy with it. Please rise.
"'Tis midnight and on all is brown. The star is dim that lately shone. Tis midnight in the garden now. The suffering Savior prays alone. Tis midnight and from all removed, the Savior wrestles long with fears. E'en that disciple who loved heeds not his master's grief and tears. 'Tis midnight and for others' guilt a man of sorrows weeps in blood. Yet he that has in anguish knelt is not forsaken by his God. night and from heaven's plains is born the song that angels know. Unheard by mortals are the strains that sweetly soothe the Savior's brow. 'Tis midnight and on all is brow the star is dim that lately shone. 'Tis midnight in the garden now the suffering Savior prays alone.
Thank you. No, don't clap. That's something that you want to keep with you. Tells it all. He took everything and replaced it with love and life with him afterwards. So keep that in your hearts. And I don't know, Doug, where do you want to do a benediction? Or he says that's it. Daryl?
Beautiful, Tom. Thank you. In the book of Revelation, it is the only book that really sums up the end. Everything points to it, and there's so much to it. He's given us so much, everything that we need in this world to live a godly life. All we have to do is look to him. So that I encourage each and every one of us as he takes us on this journey and teaches us to lose ourselves and look to him. He will show us life and give us life like no one else can. So until that time, may the Lord shine his face upon you. May he bless you and may he keep you. As you walk this week, may you look to him in all things. Just want to remind you that everybody after our service today, there is soup and bun for everybody. We can eat together and fellowship together. So go in peace. Amen.